What exactly happened during SpaceX's Starship Flight 7? Let's discuss. Hey, I'm Lucas. Welcome to the SpaceX community. Let's get started. SpaceX successfully launched Starship Flight 7 on January 16, 2025. The mission included a new Block 2 Starship upper stage, Ship 33, and a Block 1 Super Heavy Booster, Booster 14. The liftoff occurred at 4:37 p.m. under the watchful eyes of the Federal Aviation Administration, FAA, which had granted two potential launch windows for the day. The weather cooperated, providing ideal conditions for what was to be a pivotal test in the realm of reusable space technology. Starship, now towering at 403 feet with all its recent upgrades, blasted off smoothly. This rocket isn't just about reaching space. It's about changing how we get there by being reusable. This particular mission, though, had its eyes set on several key objectives, the most notable being the recovery of the Super Heavy booster. The booster itself performed its part of the mission flawlessly. 7 minutes after lifting off, it started its descent back to Earth. Here's where the real drama unfolded. Or rather, didn't unfold, thanks to the successful execution of a complex maneuver. The booster was caught by the launch tower's chopstick arms, a feat that had only been accomplished once before. This was a big moment for SpaceX, as they had made several hardware updates to make sure the booster didn't end up in the water like the last time. These updates included better sensor protections to enhance the reliability of the catch. While the booster's recovery was a success, the upper stage of Starship faced challenges. This section of the spacecraft was tasked with carrying 10 Starlink simulators, which are essentially dummy satellites used to replicate the performance of SpaceX's operational Starlink satellites. The plan was for this upper stage to execute a controlled descent into the Indian Ocean, but unfortunately, the mission did not go as planned. During the launch, there was a noticeable tear in the stainless steel structure of this part of the ship, located at the left end of the video. It's not entirely clear whether this tear resulted in a hole or was merely superficial damage to another part of the structure. We'll revisit this incident in upcoming episodes, and hopefully, SpaceX will provide further clarification on what happened. Let's review the footage again for a closer look. The mission also highlighted some of the new hardware on Starship. The propulsion system now carries 25% more propellant, which could mean longer missions or more payload capacity. Also, the forward flaps were redesigned for better heat resistance during the fiery return through Earth's atmosphere. These changes are all part of SpaceX's effort to make Starship not just another rocket, but the backbone of their vision for space exploration and colonization. SpaceX isn't just about sending rockets into space. They're about making space accessible to everyone, or at least more people than before. The company's chief operating officer, Gwynne Shotwell, has been vocal about their commitment to innovation and making space travel as routine as air travel. This mission was another step towards that goal, showing the world that catching a massive rocket booster with mechanical arms is not just science fiction. The narrative of Starship, however, isn't solely about technological achievements. It's also intertwined with regulatory and environmental considerations. Elon Musk has set an ambitious target of 25 Starship flights for 2025, indicating a significant increase in testing frequency. But this ambition comes with scrutiny. The FAA is currently dealing with public comments regarding the environmental impact of these launches, which have been a point of contention for local communities and environmentalists alike. Despite these challenges, SpaceX remains optimistic, navigating through regulatory waters with the same zeal they apply to their engineering problems. This particular test flight, dubbed Starship 7, encapsulates the essence of SpaceX's mission: pushing boundaries while learning from each endeavor. The loss of the upper stage, while a setback, is a reminder of the complexities of spaceflight. Each flight, each failure, feeds into a cycle of improvement. SpaceX's approach has always been about rapid iteration. where even the most significant challenges are viewed as opportunities to learn and evolve. Looking at the bigger picture, Starship is not just another rocket. It's a vehicle for a new era of space exploration. It's designed to take humans to Mars, to the Moon, and potentially beyond, all at a fraction of the current cost. The success of the booster catch not only proved the concept, but also gave hope to those dreaming of a future where space travel is more than a billionaire's playground. In terms of what's next, SpaceX will likely use the data from this flight to refine their systems further. They'll tweak designs, reassess risks, and prepare for the next test, knowing that each flight brings them closer to their ultimate goals. The public, the scientific community, and space enthusiasts around the globe will be watching closely, knowing that every launch, every recovery, and every failure is a step towards making the impossible possible. I'd like to quickly remind you to subscribe to our channel if you haven't already. You know, we're on a mission to reach 65,000 subscribers by next week. Join us on this journey, and let's see if we can make it happen together. Rocket Lab has publicly urged the incoming administration to rethink NASA's strategy for the Mars Sample Return MSR mission, claiming it can achieve the mission's goals more rapidly and at a lower cost than NASA's proposed alternatives. On January 7th, 2025, NASA revealed it would dedicate the next 18 months to analyzing two different architectural approaches for MSR. The first approach would employ a sky crane landing mechanism, similar to those used for the Curiosity and Perseverance rovers, to deploy a sample retrieval lander on Mars. The second strategy involves using a commercially developed heavy lander for the same purpose. This announcement came after NASA reviewed a series of studies commissioned in mid-2024 from both industry leaders and NASA's own research centers. Among these, Rocket Lab's proposal was unique, as it was awarded a study contract later than most others. Rocket Lab's plan involves an integrated system leveraging its proprietary technologies, including launch vehicles, spacecraft, and other systems, to execute an end-to-end MSR mission. While their architecture mirrors NASA's earlier concepts, featuring a sample retrieval lander, a Mars ascent vehicle for launching samples into Mars orbit, and an Earth return orbiter for bringing the samples back, Rocket Lab claims it can execute this plan at a significantly reduced cost and timeline. According to NASA's evaluations, the two architectures under consideration could range from $5.8 billion to $7.7 billion, with sample returns expected between 2035 and 2039. This represents a considerable improvement over previous estimates that pegged the cost at up to $11 billion with a return date in 2040. However, Rocket Lab's Vice President of Business Development and Strategy for Space Systems, Richard French, asserts that their approach could bring samples back for less than $4 billion, with a target return as early as 2031. French did not delve into the specifics of how Rocket Lab achieved these projections, but highlighted the company's broad capabilities. These include developments from the Neutron launch vehicle, collaborations with Varda Space Industries on re-entry technology, and the Victus Haze mission for the U.S. Space Force, which involves complex space operations like rendezvous and proximity maneuvers. These projects, according to French, are directly advancing the skills necessary for a successful MSR mission. Despite the innovation and cost-saving promises of Rocket Lab's proposal, the company has faced a lack of significant feedback from NASA. French expressed frustration over the minimal response to their study inputs, suggesting that NASA's approach to continuing with further studies rather than moving directly to implementation is counterproductive. He advocates for NASA to foster a commercial competition for the MSR project, arguing that this would not only drive down costs, but also accelerate the project timeline through competitive innovation. The idea is that NASA would first select multiple proposals for preliminary studies before choosing one to execute the revamped MSR program. This strategy, French argued, would be not only more cost-effective, but also align with the push towards leveraging commercial capabilities in space missions. He pointed out that NASA is seeking at least $300 million in the final fiscal year 2025 budget to continue studying the two options it currently contemplates, suggesting that initial studies with various commercial providers could be a more efficient use of funds and time. Rocket Lab's call for a commercial competition isn't isolated. The Planetary Society shares similar concerns regarding NASA's decision to extend the study phase rather than commit to a definitive path. In a statement dated January 8, 2025, the Planetary Society expressed worry over the ongoing delays in decision-making for the MSR program, which has been on pause for over 2 years. They urged the incoming Trump administration to expedite decisions and encourage Congress to ensure sufficient funding is available to move forward with the project. The sentiment reflects a broader frustration among stakeholders about the pace of progress. French commented on the irony of NASA spending a year to assess outcomes only to decide on studying further, emphasizing the need to move into early design phases rather than more conceptual exploration. The debate over how to proceed with MSR is emblematic of larger discussions within the space community about the role of government versus private enterprise in space exploration. Rocket Lab's proposal challenges NASA to rethink its approach, suggesting that a blend of government oversight with commercial execution could redefine how significant scientific missions are conducted, potentially setting a new standard for efficiency and cost-effectiveness in space exploration. On January 15th, a SpaceX Falcon 9 rocket lifted off from Kennedy Space Center's Launch Complex 39A at 1:11 a.m. Eastern, carrying two moonbound landers from different companies with distinct lunar ambitions. The rocket's upper stage conducted two burns before releasing Firefly Aerospace's Blue Ghost, one lander approximately 65 minutes into the flight. Shortly thereafter, it executed a third burn to deploy iSpace's Hakuto-R M2 resilience lander about 93 minutes after launch, setting both into transfer orbits around Earth. This launch marked a unique instance of mission sharing where both commercial entities, Firefly from the US and iSpace from Japan, capitalized on a single launch opportunity, a decision orchestrated by SpaceX. Juliana Scheiman, director of NASA science missions at SpaceX, explained at a pre-launch briefing that the company had matched these payloads to optimize the use of the Falcon 9's capacity. She highlighted that this collaboration not only made economic sense by reducing launch costs for both companies, but also demonstrated SpaceX's capability to manage complex space logistics. Blue Ghost 1, with Firefly at the helm, embarked on a relatively quick lunar journey. After spending about 25 days in Earth's orbit, it was set to execute a translunar injection maneuver, reaching lunar orbit after another 4 days. The lander was then scheduled for a 16-day orbit to calibrate its vision navigation system and prepare for a landing attempt in the Mare Crisium region on March 2nd. Jason Kim, Firefly's CEO, underscored the significance of this mission at a NASA briefing, noting the meticulous preparation by Firefly's team, despite the company being better known for its launch vehicles. In contrast, iSpace's resilience lander opted for a low-energy trajectory, much like its predecessor in the 2022 mission, aiming for a landing in Mare Frigoris. The journey was projected to take about 4 to 5 months, a strategy to conserve fuel and resources. Takeshi Hakamada, iSpace's CEO, during their own briefing, emphasized that the design of the lander was intentionally compact to accommodate such rideshare opportunities, a shift from their first mission's dedicated launch approach to cut costs. The arrangement for this shared launch was only publicly confirmed in December, surprising many in the industry who expected separate launches for each lander. The decision to rideshare came after both companies approached SpaceX independently, leading to a strategic pairing that benefited both in terms of cost and timing. Blue Ghost 1 is primarily serving NASA under the Commercial Lunar Payload Services CLPS program, carrying 10 science and technology demonstration payloads. These include experiments to study lunar regolith adhesion, navigation signal usage in cislunar space, and a heat probe designed to drill up to 3 meters beneath the lunar surface. Maria Banks, the CLPS project scientist, detailed how the landing site was carefully chosen to avoid magnetic anomalies and ensure the success of these experiments within the lander's operational window before the lunar sunset. On the other hand, Resilience, although not part of NASA's CLPS program directly, carries its own set of scientific payloads from various international institutions, including a small rover named Tenacious from iSpace's European branch. This rover aims to collect lunar regolith, part of a NASA contract to establish a precedent for lunar resource utilization. However, this aspect of the mission received less coverage, with NASA officials at the pre-launch briefing showing limited awareness of this contract. The mission also had a cultural element, with iSpace's Resilience carrying a model house named Moonhouse, an artistic endeavor by a Swedish artist showcasing the intersection of art and space exploration. For Firefly, this mission represents their inaugural lunar landing attempt, with 2 more missions lined up under NASA's CLPS. Chris Colbert, NASA's CLPS program manager, acknowledged the challenges of lunar landings but expressed confidence in Firefly's capabilities. iSpace, meanwhile, is looking to redeem itself after its first lander's unsuccessful attempt in April 2023 due to a software issue. The crash was a hard lesson, but as Ryo Ujie, CTO of iSpace, conveyed, it left the team with a resolve to learn and improve. Hakamada highlighted a new campaign in Japan that embraces failure as a stepping stone for success, promoting resilience in the face of setbacks. This dual mission underscores not only the technical and logistical challenges of space travel, but also the collaborative spirit and innovative approaches in the burgeoning commercial space sector. It's a testament to how shared resources and cooperative strategies can propel humanity's exploration of the cosmos forward. Thanks for watching today's episode. Don't forget to subscribe and give us a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Stay tuned for another great video tomorrow.